Good afternoon and welcome to Uppercut. I'm Kevin.
I'm Elena.
And I'm Dave, and we'll be your hosts for the next half hour here on CIUT's program of progressive, punchy, and persuasive politics.
Coming up on the show today, I guess last week we had lots of interviews. This week we've got lots of news for you and commentary and what else?
Oh, a few rants.
What
some
else
updates.
Can you expect? And, of course, our usual assortment of music and...
Great music this week, so if you stay tuned for anything, stay tuned for that. We'll be back right after this short break.
Welcome back to Uppercut. That was Ripcords with Silicon Teens.
One of our very favorite bands out of Montreal.
All right. So I guess it's been a pretty busy week for all of us. Yesterday was quite a day. There was the demonstration we talked about on the show last week, the Jewish Feminist Anti-Fascist League and Anti-Racist Action co-sponsored a demonstration commemorating the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising of 50 years ago. The rally started at 519 Church Street Community Center at around 5:30, which apparently was the time that the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising started against the Nazi occupation in Poland, and in particular the deportations of Jews to concentration camps from the Warsaw Ghetto. The uprising lasted, I think, 43 days altogether, and was a really, really inspiring act of resistance. So yesterday was a commemoration of that, and also kind of bringing that, those lessons and the inspiration into the present day and into the future, I hope. Talking about the neo-Nazi groups in Toronto and other acts of racism and anti-Semitism and homophobia in Toronto. And I guess it was a pretty strong rally. There's about 300 people at the info rally, and then we marched from there down to Allen Gardens as a group. And the Allen Gardens was a significant place because actually for a lot of reasons, but in the past anyways, in the 60s, it was used by the Nazi Party of Canada to rally in. They apparently tried to rally there, but were confronted by what I was told was about 3,000 people who organized and went down and kicked their asses real good, got them right out.
20 or 30 years ago.
Yeah, so that was already a nice inspiring act, as we said, bringing the historical end of it into it. But also, we have to be aware that Allen Gardens is also has been used by today's neo-Nazi organizations to rally before, or to as a meeting point. It's also been the site of queer bashings by both Nazis and by other homophobes in Toronto, and it's also very close to the home of Nazi Ernst Zundel, who was, I guess most people know about him, but he's infamous for mostly publishing hate propaganda, and his international connections are really interesting because he sends so much hate propaganda over to Germany and helps to fuel what's going on over there with Nazi groups trying to attack all sorts of immigrants, people of color, lesbians and gays, and people with disabilities, things like that. So I think it was a good rally. It was very kind of high-spirited and lots of really good energy there and chants, and I'm hoping to see more from Jewish Feminist and Anti-Fascist League in the future. They seem like a totally powerful group. You got to see these people to believe, and they're just really right on and together and organized, and that was, all in all, that was my big inspiration for the week.
Yeah, I thought so too. The thing that most people noticed right away, and I certainly did, was the mix of people, especially at the info rally, just like every sort of every age range, every sort of affiliations, and we're all there. And you could tell from just the way they spoke and people's looks on their faces that they were all very moved and inspired by the anniversary that they were celebrating. And on top of that, this is the hip quotient was right up there, because it was raining, and there's nothing less hip than a march in the rain, except that people's spirits were still up.
Yeah,
people
definitely.
Were in shorts.
And, yes, well.
One person was in shorts, having a great time. And also, speaking of demonstrations, there was sort of a last-minute one. Oh, that's one thing I wanted to say about Jafawful, is that they've done their homework. They seem to know, like, you know, just almost in, it seems like kind of in the past month or whatever, they've just gone out and they know their stuff through and through.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, they put a lot of preparation into this. On the other hand, there was this demonstration on Saturday organized by Buddies in Bad Times Theater. We spoke to Sky last week about the Queer Culture Festival that's going on and the attacks by in the right-wing press and from right-wing city councillors against the theater and the festival. It was particularly Christina Blizzard of The Sun has written a series of stories. There's also been an editorial attacking the government grants to Buddies in Bad Times Theater, and saying that one of the headlines was "Live Sex Group Gets City Bucks," when actually it's just a theater. And there's all kinds of crazy quotes, garbage, trash, and you know, all kinds of inflammatory stuff. So Buddies is countering this with their own media blitz, and had a very successful demonstration, kind of a organized in the last minute. Like in a couple days, they went out and leafleted and brought a bunch of people with Jane, who is Sky Gilbert's alter ego, and presented the Gina Mallet Award to Christina Blizzard and Tom Jakubek, city councillor. The Gina Mallet Award is given every year to those who have most hurt the Canadian arts community. And apparently it was, they were great speeches. It was quite a colorful demonstration, although they were never, of course, allowed into the Toronto Sun building. And apparently there were dozens and dozens of cops out there to protect the Sun from these drag queens and other perverts.
So what, on they didn't get to kiss them?
I don't think so.
Well, that was supposed to be the most exciting part of the demonstration.
Really. Yes, we were hoping that this would drive these people so crazy that they'd never be able to write or function again. So,
on to other news, I suppose.
Okay, Debbie Williams is another mother in jail for trying to protect her children. She lost custody of her two children in an Ohio court where the judge refused to consider the children's allegations that their father was sexually abusing them. Now, the father moved to Bloomington, Illinois, and took the children with him. Deb Williams sued for visitation and custody rights in Bloomington, but the court refused to take jurisdiction. Now, Debbie was only allowed supervised visitations, and the children were forbidden from being evaluated for sexual abuse. Now, desperate to protect her children, Debbie and her mother decided to nonviolently eject the visitation supervisor from their car and said they were taking the children to the Kemp Institute in Denver for evaluation. Debbie was then arrested and is now in jail awaiting trial on 4 felony charges. Now, the children were returned to their father. Now, Debbie needs your support right now, and I'll give you her support group number here. Fran Moore is the coordinator, and the area code is 812, and number is 339-7734.
So we'll keep you posted as we hear more about that.
Definitely.
We also have some more news on prison-type issues. Of course, most people have heard about the uprising in the Ohio prison. The standoff is still continuing. We have a report that was compiled from several sources, mostly in the States, because apparently the American press has been much more honest and open about what's going on, and the Canadian press has just been turning it into a circus rather than a political issue. So anger turned to action on April 11th as the prisoners in the Southern Ohio Correctional Facility revolted against the brutal prison regime, which runs the maximum security prison there in Lucasville. Repressive conditions and tensions resulted in an uprising in which hundreds of prisoners rioted and drove back the attacking guards. They secured their cell block and barricaded themselves in, taking 8 prison guards hostage in order to safeguard themselves against further and more violent attacks. So far, that has worked. Six prisoners died in the first day of rioting, and are said to have been beaten to death. Other prisoners are thought to be responsible for these killings as retribution for their cooperation with this regime. A 7th prisoner is reported dead, but causes remain quote-unquote unknown. Meanwhile, 450 prisoners who remain in the barricades inside the cell block have issued demands, among them a call for replacement of the warden, Arthur Tate, also known as King Arthur, and the firing of a number of particularly brutal guards, and as well the lifting of a range of repressive restrictions on day-to-day life at the maximum security facility. They are also demanding the restoration of water and electricity, which were shut off on the first day of rioting, which was April 11th. That was a long time ago. To date, the prisoners remain strong and unified in their refusal to take down the barricades or release the hostages until their demands are met. So far, they've won the delivery of food to the cell block, and on the 5th day of the standoff, the prisoners were guaranteed radio broadcast, after which they said they would release another guard, and he was released unharmed. The negotiators are requesting an FBI negotiator as opposed to administrative one, because that they say it's the administration that is oppressing them. In their radio broadcast last week, a prisoner who identified himself only as George read out their demands and explained the situation inside the prison and the conditions inmates had been forced to live under. He made it clear that they would not surrender, despite their dangerous position, saying, "We either negotiate this to our liking, or they kill us. We are prepared to die." Also, on Friday, another prisoner, Abdul Samad Mumin, faced negotiators on TV. They won their televised broadcast, which they demanded. He went on TV in the States, demanding several common things: better pay, more liberal telephone privileges, and some specifically for the freedom to practice Muslim religion. However, the interesting thing about this was what happened. They had guaranteed that if they got this televised broadcast, they would release another guard unharmed. So the two of them, Abdul and a guard named James Demons, came out of the cell of the barricades. Abdul made his demands and then returned to the cell block, leaving the guard free and unharmed and ready to leave. What was interesting about it was that as the cameras turned on this guard Demons, he began to denounce the prison system and held them accountable for what had happened and for the death that had happened in the prison, and announced that he had converted to the Muslim faith and that he stood with his brothers who were back in the prison.
Wow.
Yeah, it was pretty. Then people tried to, help him off, give him a jacket, I think it was, and he refused, and he ranted some more about how the prison administration and the negotiators didn't care about the hostages, didn't care about the system, and if they hadn't had these repressive conditions to begin with, he wouldn't have been put in the situation he was put in. Very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And to finish off here, the superior resources and firepower that the state has still not helped them. They've been forced to negotiate with the inmates on their grounds, and the inmates have been able to set the agenda and the terms of negotiations by standing together and being defiant in the spirit of total resistance. They are refusing to back down or to be intimidated, saying things as, like the quote I said before, "We are not going to give up. If we die, we die." And so the standoff continues. It is essential that the prisoners receive support so another massacre to, like the one that happened in Attica in 1970 is not allowed to take place. So we'll keep you up to date on what's happening, maybe give you some telephone numbers next week that you can respond to.
I think we should have those. On a lighter side of things, this came from the more conservative press, who sometimes actually have a sense of humor, luckily. They say it would never have happened to Perry Mason. Victoria lawyer Doug Christie is best known for his work on behalf of Ernst Zundel, Imre Finta, David Irving, and James Keekstra, and extorted Ku Klux Klan members and other Nazis. Last month, though, he acted in a more run-of-the-legal mill suit against the city of Victoria for a client who he alleged had been subjected to excessive force during the arrest. One of the arresting officers testified that Mr. Christie's client, although seated and handcuffed, had kicked him in the groin. Now, Mr. Christie argued that this was impossible, and in classic Perry Mason style, had the officer handcuffed and seated on the floor in front of the jury to demonstrate it couldn't be done. The policeman issued two warnings that this was unwise, but Mr. Christie, of course unconvinced, and ever the sharp legal mind, continued to stand over him demanding a reenactment. The officer then kicked the lawyer in the groin, causing him to double over and hop about the court in considerable pain. His client lost. Sorry, Mr. Doug Christie.
Former Director of Central Intelligence George Bush signed the Intelligence Authorization Act, FY-92, on December 4, 1991. With his signature, the act became Public Law 102-183. The National Security Education Act, a little-known provision of this huge bill, created the National Security Education Board, funding it with $150 million to implement a variety of measures affecting higher education. It aims to provide colleges and universities with the necessary resources, accountability, and flexibility to meet the national security education needs of the United States by improving the quantity, diversity, and quality of the teaching and learning of subjects in the fields of foreign languages, area studies, and other international fields that are critical to the nation's interest.
But stripped of its packaging as an educational initiative, the clear purpose of the Act is to help the intelligence branches of the United States government fill their appointed roles in the New World Order.